I accept the nomination. Well, welcome, everybody. Welcome again to what's the second largest crowd, I guess, that we've had here at the Prairie Festival. I'm tempted to say we're gathered here today. We're gathered this weekend, a day and a half, to think about religion, philosophy, history, science, art, have some music, some dance. We're here for the whole, which is to say, holy. And my reason for this lineup this year, and you can't imagine how many times I've asked, why are you putting a Prairie Festival together with like that? Well, of course, these are the unwashed that don't know anything. But the fact is, we in the Western world seem to be turning our backs on traditional religion. And some could correctly argue that's a good thing. But whether it's good or bad, we cannot deny that as a consequence, I'll call it, for want of a better term, a spiritual vacuum has developed and is now being filled with science fiction featuring utopian technology, all the way from microbes to space travel. And part of all that are scientists and others that are given to great speculation. We're going to be establishing new myths as we seek these new visions. This seems to be the way we make sense of the world. So a big question for our time is, what will be the context and the source of those new myths? If we allow it to just happen, it will. Which then makes it, I think, appropriate that our speaker this morning at this intellectual hootenanny of 2014, a term that was created by our speaker several years ago, Bill Vitek. Bill Vitek, it's meet and right that he be giving the John Donnelley lecture because he was a philosopher like Strachan. He was a member of Strachan Donnelley's stable, so to speak. He is a student of Alfred North Whitehead, as Strachan was, Hans Jonas, as Strachan was, Ernst Mayr, as Strachan was. Strachan was on our board of directors until we lost him, I think, in 2008. By the way, Vivian, are you here? Where is Vivian? Vivian is took his place on our board. Vivian is Strachan's widow. Huh. Well, okay, I bet she's here. She's just not letting anybody know. Bill's a professor at Clarkson University and head of the department. He and I have done a couple of books together. He does all the work. I get 40% of the credit. The one book that we particularly enjoyed doing was on the virtues of ignorance. It was our conviction that given that we're billions of times more ignorant than knowledgeable, we have no right to presume that knowledge is adequate to run the world. And so therefore, let's go with our long suit. Let's have an ignorance-based worldview. So we hosted that in Matfield Green several years ago, had a banner across the street that said, "Welcome ignoramuses." And we had a good time. But Bill is wonderful to work with. He's highly regarded. And He's highly regarded as a jazz musician that plays lots of gigs, and that's why he's so rich. So, Dr. Vitek.
The order of the world, the depth of reality of the world, the value of the world in its whole and in its parts, the beauty of the world, the zest of life, the peace of life, and mastery of evil are all bound together, not accidentally, but by reason of this truth, that the universe exhibits a creativity with an infinite freedom and a realm of forms with infinite possibilities. That's a short prelude written by Alfred North Whitehead. You're going to hear it again at the end of the talk, but it's a bit of a slog from here to there. If you ask a philosopher to come and talk, you're going to have to go the slow way. I'm hoping, though, that a glimpse of the destination will encourage you to make the trip with me this morning. So, first things first, good morning, Prairie Fest. Good morning. And thank you, Wes, for that introduction. I was going to say, I wish my mother could have heard it, but I'm not sure. I see some of our musicians here. Let's give a hand for that wonderful music last night. My presence here this morning signals that the hootenanny portion of the program is now officially concluded, and it's time for class. Wes and I are hoping to create a new curriculum, a perennial curriculum, and I should let you know that there will be Saturday morning classes in the new curriculum, and that's after all the chores are finished, so be ready. I'd like to start today with a couple of images of Strachan Donnelley, whose memory and legacy we celebrate this morning. The first describes his agility and pure physical energy. As Wes just mentioned, a group of us were called to Matfield Green in Kansas in June of 2004 to talk about ignorance. And I should show you, we made a t-shirt too. It was the summer 2004 ignorance tour. After a long day of talking about ignorance in the fifth grade classroom of the old school, someone found a bat and a softball and one glove, and we all headed to the field. We agreed that no one would use the only glove. Each of us gravitated to a position on the field that best reflected his or her abilities, or lack thereof. Though one of the oldest players, Strachan, went to third base, a position I only later learned he had played at Hotchkiss, and that he also played football at Yale. I went to first base only because someone had beaten me to right field. I apologize to any right fielders out there, but that's where we go. The second batter hit a line drive to Strachan's left. It was too hot to catch, so he wisely batted it to the ground. He eyed the runner's speed, he calculated the time he had to make the throw, and then in a single motion, he scooped up the ball and fired a white rocket across the infield. I watched all of this and stood with hands outstretched, awaiting the impact, and I thought, are you kidding me? And then a searing pain registered in my hands. The game went 7 innings, and Strachan became more energized as the game went on. He was fearless and in constant motion. Donnelley to Vitek recorded many outs that day. Strachan was no worse for the wear, and I had an aching welt in my right palm that lasted, I think, a month. It was just, I thought I broke some bones, actually. That's Strachan on the baseball field. The second image reflects his philosophical side. He always insisted that the great cosmologists and metaphysical thinkers of the Western philosophical tradition be at the table with modern-day economists, scientists, and policymakers. That our discussions about saving wetlands and building community in Chicago, for example, required these grand speculators and system builders to be at the center of the conversation. He called his frequent references to Heraclitus, Parmenides, Spinoza, and Whitehead philosophical riffs, a musical metaphor he understood well. And our musician friends understand that term too. Riffs are not just catchy notes. Riffs are musical memes, powerful ideas, true expressions of form. Think of the first notes of Beethoven's Fifth Symphony, or John Coltrane's explosion of notes at the beginning of his Giant Steps solo, and so many other examples. Strachan never tired of reminding us that those philosophical riffs and roots were necessary to support the policy, scientific, and legal alternatives we sought. That was music to a philosopher's ears, and I completely changed my focus away from ethics and toward metaphysics. I dug in and started reading Spinoza and Whitehead, and I thought, are you kidding me? And now it's my head that hurts. If any of you have ever read those philosophers, you would know why. And you're going to hear some of Whitehead. Strachan was a deep-thinking philosopher in restless motion, and that seems like a contradiction. But Strachan's legacy is a beautiful and powerful example of all of us who want to engage this difficult and necessary work. Thought and action must go together. Strachan was a complex and beautiful patriot for all good things wild and free. He was too briefly my mentor and tutor. I miss him. He is the inspiration behind this talk, and I deliver it with the humility of a student standing in his teacher's shadow. Oh, there's to you, Strachan. All right, we're going to get started. I want to advance three propositions today that I hope will help us all see a radical roots level transformation all around us, right under our noses. And it's been going on for about 150 years now. I believe this transformation has the horsepower, the solar power, the thinking power, the people power to heal the divides between humans and the ecosphere. It can feed our bodies, our minds, and our hearts with creative energy and motive force without requiring, in exchange, the degradation and destruction of wild earth. This, of course, is the promise of perennial agriculture, that conservation, not destruction, can be a consequence of production. My small contribution to the conversation this week is the good news that there is a perennial philosophy at work in all of this, too. Some of it you know already from the works of Henry Thoreau, Aldo Leopold, Stan Rowe, Wess, Wendell Berry, and the American agrarian tradition. I'll add to this list a British mathematician turned amateur philosopher, Alfred North Whitehead. His work is categorized as process philosophy, and he outlined in great detail what he called a philosophy of organism. I believe that Whitehead is the most important perennial philosopher, if I may use that term, of the 20th century. His ideas are now out of the seminar room, and we can see signs of them in agriculture, science, information theory, economics, medicine, and even engineering design. When we put his ideas together with the ecological tradition that begins in the 19th century, America's age of ecology, as historian Don Worcester calls it, I think we have the potential for a coordinating philosophy, a worldview, a full-fledged system of meaning. And it's not a moment too soon, because we all know the one in operation now is broken, it's outmoded, it's dangerous. We know that. What brings us to this place every September, or for the first time this weekend, is the conviction that we can feed and think our way out of this jam. I think we can, but only if the farmers and the philosophers work together. So this is about farming and philosophy coming together. So here.